নমস্কার। সিএভি করোনাকে ভয় করো না, এই অনুষ্ঠান নিয়ে আজকে আপনাদের সামনে আমরা উপস্থিত হয়েছি। আজকে আমাদের সঙ্গে রয়েছেন কৃষ্ণনগর থেকে এমপি মৌহা মৈত্র। এই মানুষটির নাম আমাদের সকলের কাছে পরিচিত, অ্যান্ড আমরা আজকে ভীষণ খুশি এবং উত্তেজিত, ভীষণ এক্সাইটেড যে আজকে দিদিকে আমরা পেয়েছি এরকম একটা প্ল্যাটফর্মে, যেখানে করোনা নিয়ে কথা বলবো এবং আরো আনুষঙ্গিক যে কথাগুলো করোনা সংক্রান্ত বিষয়ের সঙ্গে উঠে আসছে। দীর্ঘদিনের কাজের অভিজ্ঞতা দিদির রয়েছে, একেবারে গ্রাসরুট লেভেলে কাজ করেছেন তিনি বিগত 10 বছরে, এবং আজকে এখন অনেক দিন ধরে তিনি এরকম একটা প্ল্যাটফর্মের সঙ্গে রয়েছেন যেখানে তার বক্তব্য তিনি খুব স্পষ্ট করে বলে থাকেন এবং বলেন। আজকে আশা করব আমরাও সেরকম কিছু শুনতে পাবো দিদির কাছ থেকে। ডক্টর বৈদ্যনাথ ঘোষ জোশীদার আছেন সিএভির কর্ণধার, আমি তাকে অনুরোধ করব দিদিকে ওয়েলকাম জানিয়ে আজকের অনুষ্ঠান শুরু করতে।
গুড আফটারনুন টু এভরিবডি, অন বিহাফ অফ সিএভি টুডে উই আর ভেরি হ্যাপি দ্যাট উই হ্যাভ বিন জয়েন্ড বাই মহুয়া মৈত্র। শি ডাজ নট নিড অ্যান ইন্ট্রোডাকশন বাট স্টিল আই উড গিভ ওয়ান। মহুয়া মৈত্র কমপ্লিটেড হার গ্রাজুয়েশন ফ্রম মাউন্ট হোলিওক ইন ইউএস, দেন শি ওয়ার্ক ইন টপ পজিশনস ইন জেপি মর্গান এন্ড আদার ব্যাংকিং ফার্মস বোথ ইন লন্ডন অ্যান্ড নিউ ইয়র্ক, and she left that and she returned to India to work for the people, and she worked for people for a total of 10 years, and now she is a member of parliament from Krishnanagar. So you know, we've heard about Subhash Bose leaving the ICS and joining politics, but I think after that the only example we have is a Mohadi who left something such as big as a job in JP Morgan in London, and she came back to work for the people. So that's inspiring. Her first speech which she gave, which was the maiden speech, was truly inspiring to young people like me, and that is the reason we started CAV, seeing people like Mohadi, and I welcome her, and on behalf of CAV we would appreciate her presence, and we will be helping idealist MPs like her to develop policies with regards to healthcare, because we are a think tank, and we also commit on behalf of CAV to donate a good amount of money to any kind of people's cause which is very close to heart. I know she works with human rights, privacy rights, Aadhaar, she works with women issues, so that of course we will talk to Didi. Welcome Mohadi. My first question to you is that how are you personally dealing with this lockdown?
I think as public representatives there is really no line between the personal and the public anymore, so I think for most of us who are in public life and are MLAs or MPs or even Panchayat Pradhan, this is a very, very busy time. And this is really not about, I mean, I read a lot of things about, you know, people watching movies and relaxing. And I think that this is really not something that most of us have been able to indulge ourselves in. I think, we have, especially in a constituency like mine, more than 50% of the workforce is in different states. So we have a lot of migrant labor who are stranded everywhere. And the district administration and public representatives are obviously inundated with phone calls and, you know, how are these people going to eat? Where are they staying? When can they come back? Their families are not being able to get the wages remitted. So how are you going to feed them? So these are very real, very pressing issues that have to be dealt with on a daily basis in a district. I'm also district president of my district. So in our district, all the blocks that fall in my constituency, every single block has had to have isolation centers, quarantine centers. We've got to ramp up capacity to have COVID hospitals. So all of this, I think, is obviously a lot of work. And, we're all worried that we haven't seen the last of this or the worst of this. So I think every day is preparation for the next. I don't think we are anywhere near flatlining yet. So obviously, I think at this time, it's a very stressful time, and it's also time to show leadership, I think.
Mohadi, there is another issue. One is that the government has asked people to maintain the lockdown, wash hands, wear masks. So what advice would you give to your constituents regarding that, like personal hygiene and that area?
You know, I read something the other day, and it's very true. It's something we all feel, is when you see even washing hands to a lot of people, not so much in Bengal because we don't have water shortage, but even washing hands, social distancing, this is something that is an indulgence that is usually for the middle class and the rich. Because if you think about people who are on the wrong side of the poverty line, they are living in very cramped conditions. If you're thinking of migrants today who are stuck in other places, even in shelters or even in people who are living in slums, who are living in labor camps, there are 10 to 12 people in a room where I could be living in alone. So I think social distancing is very difficult for people like that. I think when there's water scarcity, then washing hands is difficult. So I think given these are challenges that a lot of the developed world doesn't have to face, that we necessarily have to face. And, you know, obviously he's taken the advice to at least lick me, if not wash his hands very seriously. But, you know, this is something that is we've got to make people understand at this point, this is not something that comes naturally to people. They don't get it. They just don't get it. So I think especially in rural areas, the idea that bheed korbenna, don't go into crowded places, maintain a distance. They're used to if they're indoors. Nobody in my rural area is indoors. They're all outdoors. Yeah. So if you ask them to sit inside the house, houses are small. So they can't understand. When you're asking them to be in an isolation center with somebody, they say, he might be having it. I'm better off at home. So I want to go home. So these are great challenges. But having said that, I think it is very important at this time that even if washing hands and doing some very minimal steps reduces chances by 40 or 50%, they're saying it's even more than that, then it's something that we've got to use whatever means available to us to make people understand and to make people, you know, get to a point where they can do it. It's very important.
Okay. Yeah. Didi, if you had to give a message to the people of India and the youth of India at this critical juncture, what would your message be?
I think the message is that, look, this is in times like this is when you realize that India is essentially a poor country. No matter how we kid ourselves into believing that, you know, the cities are fantastic and we have malls and we have shopping and we have this and we have that. In times like this, you realize that that what you're seeing on your TV screens today are not pictures of you and me. What you're seeing are people on the streets, how they're living, how millions and millions of people in India are just dependent on daily wages. And I think that reality has got to hit home to all the youth, especially to the educated middle-class youth who sometimes feel that they are part of a separate India and don't have a sort of lens on this reality. And this is something that's very important. And I think this is when people need to wake up within themselves and realize that we are born in a poor country and we must do whatever we can to help others who are less fortunate than us. And by that, I don't always mean monetary support, but I think it's empathy that's very important. Like I saw yesterday when so many migrants spilled onto the roads, a lot of people are saying, oh, why are they coming out? Why don't they just stay where they are? You know? Well, they're coming out because there are 10 of them in a room which is 5x6. That's why they're coming out and they want to get home. I mean, is that so difficult to understand? So I think a sense of empathy for, which I see missing in a very large part of the educated elite as well as educated middle-class youth, is very important in times like this. The idea that we are all in this, that there is no one community or any one segment which is responsible. This disease really knows no boundaries. So I think these are some things, lessons that are very applicable to all of us. And also that we need to give back to society in whichever way possible.
Yeah, Didi, there is a very interesting thing about you that you studied in the US, you worked in New York, you worked in London, and you came back to India to work for the poor. Now, something must have motivated you. Now, I'm not talking about COVID. If you want to give a message to the youth about activism and about doing something for the country, what would that be?
You know, everyone doesn't have to do what I did. We all have our different paths. We all have different paths in our life, and it doesn't make anyone any greater or lesser because that path may be different from mine or that path may be different from yours. It's very important to understand. And I'm no saint because I did what I did. I mean, I felt it from within, so I did it. It doesn't make me a saint. And somebody else could be doing it in a very different way while being still a banker or something else. And it doesn't take away from that. That's important to understand that everyone has their own path and you must chart it. But what I would tell the youth is, whatever your path is today, you cannot have an exclusionary path. Today, we realize that we cannot have an exclusionary path. When something like this happens, we are all in this together. So in our daily lives, no matter where you work, no matter how much money you earn, no matter how isolated you may feel, your nuclear family and your near and dear ones are, in times like this, you realize we're all in this together. And it's important that whenever you chart the course of your life, that there is room in it to give back to people and to give back to society. And you can choose your own path. There is no one set path, but you must do it. You must do it in however small a way you think is important.
Didi, another important point I want to tell you. On behalf of CAV, we have been running psychiatric services. We have a 24/7 helpline. It is 98301-77145. Because
98301-77145. Okay.
Yeah. I'll repeat it again. 98301-77145. Because in these times when COVID has no treatment, it has no vaccine, and we are locked in our homes, so people are scared. So normally in psychiatric terms, people have secondary traumatic stress, depression, anxiety. So we are operating this helpline 24/7 to give online counseling to people. So if you think anyone requires it, anyone, they can call us. We are doing counseling by phone and by Zoom, and we are doing them therapy online. And Didi, if you have any questions with regards to mental health, you can ask me, because that is a very, yeah, please.
This is a very, very important service that you started, and I would urge you really, because right now medical staff and everybody else we're connected to the healthcare sector are so involved in just fighting the pandemic. Obviously, we're not being able to give enough resources to the mental health part of it, which is very, very important. I mean, this is something, I see my mother and father, they're locked in something, they're not feeling good about it. You're looking at people who could be, you know, poor migrants who are stuck in a room, who don't know when they'll go home and don't know when they'll get to eat. And, you know, you've had instances of people jumping out the window in from the hospital, right? Yeah, so this sense of frustration, this sense of helplessness, of not knowing, this is when health counseling is the most important. So I think this is a fabulous initiative. And obviously, in whatever limited way that you can, 98301-77145, I think you said it was. It's very important that we publicize this and put it on Facebook, put it out on social media. Even if you can take 50 calls a day, I think that's 50 people helped. It's very, very important. It's something that is required, and especially in all the camps and in all the quarantine and isolation centers. I hope very quickly that every state government can ramp it up and make it a vital part of the daily activities. So any kind of counseling, that is very important.
Yeah. So Didi, basically we have done three medical briefs. One is related to COVID. One is related to the psychiatric aspect of COVID. And the third is how we can do the tracing and testing and all that. So we will just speak on the psychiatric aspect. Basically, Didi, our recommendations are that people shouldn't continuously watch COVID-related news, because nowadays people are just glued to the TV and watching news 24/7. So we advise people watch WHO, CDC or news for 10 to 30 minutes. Do exercise regularly, yoga, pranayam, read books, talk with your kids, do your normal work. And the most people who are affected are the children, because they are very scared. And we are getting calls that children are eating too much or eating less. They are bedwetting. They are getting restless. So we are telling parents that the better you can cope, the better your kids can cope. And explain your kids about COVID, and explain to them that it's a disease, but we'll be fine if you follow the rules. And we have a detailed brief. So if you want, we can send them to you. And as we discussed, all kinds of public health issues we will be working on, and if we can help very idealistic MPs like you, it would be our honor. And Meghnadi, would you like to ask a psychiatric question to me?
Yes, of course. Yes, actually the thing is this lockdown extended more 15 to 20 days, I think. So people are really, really thinking that is 14th April, it's a Navabarsho and Bola Boishak. They want to celebrate in some other way. But the thing is this, again, we got to know that is we have to maintain this lockdown more 15 days. So this fatigueness, whatever I was telling you, asking you, that is that fatigueness and irritations, like seeing the regularly the known people at the same place, same time, each and every moment, 24/7. So how to accept these things? This is a fact. And sometimes maybe some reality is like they're not taking the measure. Sometimes they're just very casual. Sometimes they're not doing the thing what you want, basically. So you are running the thing, that whatever the household work, but somebody is not listening to me.
I get you. I get your point.
Yes.
I get your point. Mohadi, do you have any specific mental health question you would like to ask or discuss?
See the issue again, when we are talking again, Vaidyanath, when we ask this, you know, that half of the people that this video might reach may be worried about, oh, their kids are at home and eating too much. But frankly, the problem for me, at least, for most of us, are that we are catering to people who are lining up for 6 till 6 a.m. to get free food from the shelter camp. So yeah. The issue for more than half of India is not that their kids are eating too much, but what are their kids going to eat at all? So unfortunately, unlike Germany and unlike the West and unlike Denmark, we're stuck in a situation where the problems for 10% of India are very different from the problems of 90% of India.
Absolutely.
So we have to decide, who do you want to cater to? Am I going to sit and give advice about you should do yoga, you should do pranayama, you should paint a picture, you should think deep into yourself, you should bake a cake, you should make sure your kids are eating healthy? Yes, that's important. But I think people who are in that bracket have enough news in the internet to entertain themselves and to know which way to go. I think today, at least for people like us in where we sit, and for doctors and for medical professionals, it is more important. And I say more important because we're just talking of the root majority in India, just happens to be, again, the poor and the lower middle class. Is very important for them. What do we tell them? How do we tell them that, you know, for them, it's about their eating. Just the bare minimum. They are not being able to get out. As of the 20th of April, they will be able to get out. And the relaxations of, I think, being able to do agricultural work, NREGA, all of those essential services opening up is going to be a huge boon. Now, once that opens up, keeping that and keeping social distancing in mind is going to be the most important thing. And I think we should also be prepared that this is not something this is going to go away. May 3rd is not set in stone. There is always a chance that could further extend depending on where this disease is going. I mean, we could have 8-week or 10-week lockdowns. We don't know yet. So I think it's very important that once we have agriculture and a lot of essential services opening up, that I think that the most of the mental health problems that are affecting the wage earning class are going to get better. And we've got to be, I think, getting the migrants back to where they originally come from is a big challenge in front of the government, in front of us. Once they come back, where you keep them, how they come back, since when can they go back and again rejoin earning or employment opportunities? Or are you going to be able to give them local employment? I mean, these are big issues. So I think food security, wage security are the two big reasons for mental health issues right now among the poor. And that's something that we've got to deal with.
Okay, so basically I will address Mohadi's question first and then I'm going to come to Meghnadi. Mohadi, you will be happy to know that Dr. Ujjaini Halim, she's associated with the United Nations and she has made a draft on migrant workers and poor and the issues of food. So in response to that, we created a policy paper on the psychiatric and medical response to the poor and the migrant workers. Now there are two studies. One is a Lancet study and the other is a study which is done by WHO. Which says that the migrant workers and the poor you mentioned, they are at great risk because number one, they're not a job, so they don't have money in their hands. Many of them are dependent on health insurance from their employers. They're going back to their villages, but their village is not taking them because they fear that you might be carrying the disease. Many of them are trapped. And these people have low education, so access of information to them is limited. So these people are at risk of normal disease, normal morbidity and psychiatric problems. So the response that we have devised is that the government should develop shelters where these people are initially to give them food and other facilities, medical facilities, and counseling should be started for all migrant workers, poor, and the population which is transient, because they are the most risk for mental health. As you said, that people who are in the houses and are internet fine, they can read a book, but a person who doesn't have food can't read a book. So what we have written our policy papers that counseling should be made mandatory for all these people because they are the most vulnerable, and even information about COVID because they're not educated to understand that what is COVID or why you should wash your hands. And the second thing I would answer Meghnadi, well, how do we deal with this condition? And I would give the example of famous Pakistani politician Benazir Bhutto. She lived 5 years in Sukkur jail and she developed a way of tackling the lockdown. She would get up in the morning, exercise, read her paper, eat her food, write her biography, and then she would talk to the warden and she would repeat it. And she developed this way to cope with the stress of lockdown. Similarly, Pandit Nehru, Mohadi, I'm sure you know, he wrote two books when he was in Ahmednagar Fort. One was The Discovery of India.
As did Newton.
As did Newton. Yeah, great. So he was in lockdown for 14 years, but he wrote two books. So what we say is that even if you're in lockdown, have a routine. Don't watch news. Exercise, eat, write, read, spend time with your kids, this too will pass. And of course, what you said about the migrant workers, very important. We are working on that. And we think that counseling should be made mandatory to everyone in every shelter, in every migrant worker shelter. And we will be doing that. So basically, Momwadi, thank you so much for coming.
Thank you.
Expressing your views.
Thank you very much. And thank you for this lovely initiative. And I wish you all success. And we hope we can take it forward in a time like this. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Okay.
Thanks. Thank you so very much, Momwadi.
Thank you.
Thanks for being here.
Thank you.
Okay. Today we got Moha Moitro, MP of Krishnagar, and we are really, really very grateful to her. And she has mentioned so many things, that is daily wages, laborer, the problem with their food, with their mental health. And Dr. Boydunath just mentioned all these points. And CAV, from this platform, we have mentioned so many things in our proposal, and there is a policy paper that we are going to publish, or we are going to give to the government, that that can be possible, that daily wages, laborer, their food problem, their mental health problem, everything, we can just talk on this. So friends, we will be back again with another guest in this platform, and stay safe, stay healthy, stay at home. Thanks for watching us in this platform. Thank you so very much.